Ladies and gentlemen, may I have your attention, please?
Let's go, Kane! Let's go, Kane!
The show starts in 3, 2, 1, go.
Good morning, Kane Sport. It's the 1st of October, 2024. I'm Gary Furman, the publisher of KaneSport.com, joined again this morning by everybody's favorite managing editor, Matt Schodel, as we discuss the news of the day, presented today by Caneswear, your ultimate authority for all University of Miami-related merchandise. If you want it, they have it at Caneswear. You could shop their store at 2655 South University Drive in Davie, or visit them at caneswear.com. Matt, based on what the people in the YouTube comments are saying, at this point, I'm supposed to just shut up and let you talk, okay? Because, I mean, people are complaining. I go on too much at the beginning of the show. They have to wait and wait and wait to start getting their fix of Schodel. I'll set the table. We got the chance to talk to Mario twice yesterday, and then coordinator Shannon Dawson and Lance Guidry. Matt, your thoughts? There you go. A minute and 10 seconds in.
Seriously? I wasn't ready. I mean, I spend the first 8 minutes yawning. I have to actually speak now.
Man, I got to take care of your fan club.
Yeah, they spoke yesterday, yes. listen,
throwing it back to me?
No, I mean, I'll talk a little bit about it, I guess. Mario Cristobal yesterday seemed pretty upbeat. Didn't really say much interesting other than Ruben Bain's going to be back, which is a big deal. But he won't really give any updates on anybody else.
He said, that's
if you believe it. I believe him when he says someone's back. I don't believe him when he says someone's day-to-day, week-to-week. Like, that doesn't mean anything to me, you know?
He said he felt pretty good about Jaden Harris.
Yeah,
that was the most injury associated news you'll ever get out of Mario.
Yeah, I mean, he probably feels pretty good about Jimmy Hoffa too, but I don't think Jimmy Hoffa's coming back to play this week. Okay, an old school reference, but I don't think most people know who he is. Anyway, you know, my favorite part was Lance Guidry. You know, holds his usual press conference. And he's, you know, one of these Louisiana good old boys, you know, and looks like he should just be sort of having a party up there. You know, he sort of wings it, which I love. He's not your politician coordinator, your politician coach, which is, I really do love that.
He's the best.
And yeah. So he answers some just general questions and, you know, a couple of interesting points. One is that he does not at all regret almost losing the game with his defensive scheme at the end. He would do it again. Even if he caught the...
I was fascinated by that.
Even if that receiver had caught the ball in the end zone for the winning touchdown... I do it the exact same way, he says. And you know what? As he explained it, I actually didn't disagree, because his point was, why should I rush 5 or 6 when we have him get into the quarter to drones the entire game anyway? And the previous series on a 3rd and long, I did send the house and he converted it. So, like, why would I do that? He says, so I just put everyone back in the end zone, let him jump ball it. You know, we'll just see what happens. You know, I'll take my chances with that. Now, my personal argument would be, if the other team's getting a touchdown on that play, I would probably not do the same exact thing. A, it sounds like you're an idiot if you lost the game on that play, which they almost did. And then you say, I'd do it anyway. I'd do it again. Would Mario Cristobal say, I wouldn't take a knee again? Of course you're going to take a knee. Like, admit you made a mistake, right? The way it played out, it was really dangerous what he did. They could have lost the game, should have lost the game, would have lost the game. I don't know, whatever O-U-L-D letter you want to put in front of that, O-U-L-D, would, could, should, I don't know. But, like, I hope he doesn't do the same thing next time, because that clearly, whatever he did was not good enough, okay? It just wasn't. So he's stuck to his guns. But then my favorite part is he finishes all the questions, and, you know, the SID guy's like, any more questions for Lance Guidry? And everyone's like, no, we're sick of this guy. Get rid of him. And then Lance Guidry says, he looks at everyone, he goes, we won. We won. Like, Like, we all thought they lost in real life, and we're acting like they lost, and we're all depressed, and this program sucks. But he's telling us, we don't suck. We won. He's like a fan.
I got to go to disguise again because I got to go to campus today. And if anybody
recognizes, hey, what's wrong with that? He's a fanboy. I like fanboys. I got no problem with fanboys.
The information office is going to go crazy over you.
Why? And then Shannon Dawson, I thought, was, you know, his usual self. I mean, he sort of explained a few things, in particular the run game. He seemed to blame the running backs more than the offensive line, if you sort of read into it a little, but he didn't really want to say it like that. But clearly he said it. And when he was asked, is this what you're saying? He backed off it. But clearly it's what he said initially, was that the running backs aren't seeing the holes. Like, that's what he said. And then after you ask him about it, he's like, oh, no, but, you know, but this and but that. And then, you know, he tries to sidestep it like the politician type stuff.
Well, which I think Cam Ward's also audibling out of some running plays, too. I got that impression.
Yeah, there's no doubt about that also. Yeah. But when they are running, he clearly made it sound like the tracks are wrong. He says when he sees on film, he sees running lanes and he sees the running backs not going to them. He clearly said that. And then he backed off it after he said that. So, like, whatever, Shannon, stick to your guns, man. Either the running backs are going to the wrong holes or they're not. And put in the running backs that are going to the right holes. How about that? There's a novel idea. Don't run the prevent defense if it gives up a touchdown. And have your running backs in the game who run into the holes and not into the defenders. I could be a coordinator. These are genius ideas. I'm a genius. I'm on the Mensa football scale right now. Like, these are amazing ideas. I should write these down. Right, don't run into defenders if you're running back. And don't do plays that give up touchdowns. Try something different next time.
Let me start Lance Guidry. He should have put pressure on the quarterback. I like that prevent defense is not Lance Guidry's style. Okay. And I love Lance Guidry. I love the way he coaches defense. I think he's a huge asset for the program. But I think he cheated himself on that last drive when he went with a 3-man rush, most of it, and did not put pressure on the quarterback. And I understand Elijah Alston was running by the quarterback and missing tackles and that he didn't have his starters weren't performing at 100% and the whole thing. I get it all, but Lance Guidry defense is not to be passive and let somebody just sit there and pick you apart. Okay. And I'm sorry, like 9 times out of 10, when I see defensive coordinators go to prevent defense late in games, they get picked apart. So I know what it's designed to do, but it doesn't often succeed in doing what it's designed to do. And what ends up happening is the offense systematically goes down the field, and before you know it, they're throwing it in the end zone. And he did say that, like, if I'm ending the game with the defense, with the offense throwing the ball in the end zone, then, like, I can't remember whether, I'd have to look and see what word he used to describe that. But he did bring it up and said that his instinct is to put pressure, but in this case he decided that he would not put pressure. And you're right. He said if he had to do it all over again, he would do the same thing all over again. And that's where I started grimacing a little bit, because, like I said, I love me Lance Guidry, man. I mean, I really do. Like, he is a very, very cool guy. You know, the kind of guy that you'd love to just go get, you know, hang out in the bar with for 3 hours and shoot the shit and drink beer and you know, just a great, 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 great guy. In this case, he's, you know, he's saying he wouldn't do anything differently again. And I personally think that's a mistake. I thought it was a mistake the other night. Thank God it worked out and the replay went Miami's way. And now they can move on to the next deceivingly tough out on the schedule. And that's this week's game against Cal in Berkeley, where it's going to be a night game on the road, a lot of travel involved. And this is a team with a really, really, really good defense that might be able to give Miami some tough moments. So they've moved on. Okay. They have definitely clearly moved on, especially Shannon Dawson from the game the other night. The offense had some great moments. It had some not so great moments. He's obviously put a lot of time in with Cam to try to correct the mistakes that Cam made and just advance the offense as a whole. Now, Matt, I know people are jumping all over Damian Martinez, and I'm not going to go through all that again. But, like, whether it's regardless of whose fault it is, the running game's not good enough right now. And I don't see I didn't hear anybody disputing that. And you know Mario wants to run the ball better. I thought at halftime, it looked to me like he mandated to Shannon Dawson to run the ball more, because there was a clear effort in the third quarter to establish the running game that I thought was effective. And I thought it helped Miami in the second half to have more of a balanced type of offense. But, you know, Shannon's not wrong when he says, man, like, we were behind and I wanted to score points. Okay. And right now they have the number one passing offense in America, or number one or two in just about every category. And Cam Ward is playing at an extremely high level, other than those handful of plays where he turned the ball over. So the offense is at its best right now, Matt, when they're throwing the ball. So how do they find the will to create the balance that Shannon admittedly said, I am going to need to be more balanced at some point in the season. I am going to need this running game. I know I'm going to need this running game. They have excellent backs. I've mentioned Don Sollinger, the longtime running back coach, saying it is as good a group of running backs as he ever had at Miami. We're talking about a guy that had James, Portis, McGahee, et cetera, Frank Gore. Like, he thinks that these guys are really, really good. I do too. And, you know, I get it. Everyone's on Martinez. I watched Martinez in fall camp bust several 80-yard runs. So I know what this guy can do. And I know that I'm dying on the vine with this opinion, and people are just looking to slam this kid. But this kid is a very good running back. And so are Fletcher and Lyle and A.J. Allen and, you know, Christopher Johnson deserves to do more. So they got to get these running backs more involved, Matt. How do they do it?
Yeah, well, first of all, in fall camp, they're thudding, right? His problem right now is he's not breaking tackles. He's not pushing guys back. And he seems to be a little in his own head, unfortunately. But, yeah, he's a great running back when he's, you know, in the system. I mean, like, here's the other thing, right? Maybe he needs a fullback. Maybe he needs a tight end to come in motion on some of these running plays and help open holes for him. You know, he had a different type of running system he played in at Oregon State. A lot of eye, and Miami doesn't do that. He's not used to getting the ball on a horizontal handoff, right, where he's not already moving forward and then having to pick a hole. Like, that's not what he was doing most of the time last year, and he seems to really just not be acclimating to it. I don't understand why. It shouldn't be that big a deal. But in terms of the bigger question, yes, Miami has to get its running game going. You're not going to win a national championship. Like, if your goal is to win the national championship, you need to be a team that can run for 200 yards a game. You need to be multidimensional. So when another team says, we're taking away your pass, right? We're just going to, you know, drop these guys and just keep whatever, 5-6 in the box. And, like, you know, it's hard to consistently throw against that. They have to make other teams wary of the run. You just can't succeed otherwise. Now, if their goal is just to win the ACC, then I would argue that, you know, maybe it's better to just pass the ball 80% of the time. But if you look historically at teams that pass 80% of the time, you know, these wide open offenses and, you know, that whole theory, right, the air raid, they never win championships. They just don't.
They meet their maker when it gets to be tough. No question.
You need to be balanced. There's a reason for that, right? It eats up clock, keeps the other team off the field, okay? Because you can't, if you're running 80 plays on offense, all passing the ball, your defense gets worn out also. And then that's been a big problem for these teams that do just throw the ball 80% of the time. Because if you're throwing even 60, 70% completions, you're stopping the clock a lot. And other teams are grinding up the clock, grinding up your defense, running more plays, and things like that. So you know, it's really important to get the run game going. Now, with that said, it's you know, it's going to be frustrating for fans if it doesn't work. Because, like, there's a reason Shannon Dawson said we have to stick with it no matter what. Even if you get 1 or 2 yards a carry in the first three quarters, you've got to stick with it unless you fall behind by a lot. And the reason for that is what I just said. You know, you can't be a one-dimensional team and be a champion. You just can't in this modern day of college football. It used to be just run the ball, don't even pass it. And that sort of works sometimes, right? But not today. Not with the multiple defenses you face and the way these other defense coordinators will scheme you up if that's all you can do. So I don't think we really know yet that Miami can't run the ball. I just think we know they haven't run the ball consistently successfully. And I think over the next 2 or 3 games, we're going to get a definitive answer, because there's no doubt in my mind that this is making Mario Cristobal insane. Insane. If you asked him before the season if he would rather be known as a great running team or a great passing team, and he can only pick one of those, he's picking running team. And it's not even close. He'll answer that question before we even finish. He'll answer that question before we even finish asking it, okay? So this is making them nuts. And, you know, I know you blamed the offensive line yesterday, and that certainly is part of it. But the running back's play has also been part of it. And there's no doubt Damian Martinez has been a problem. And I don't know if Damian can fix Damian. I hope he gets his head on straight and really starts playing with a passion and a purpose, because that's what's been missing. You know, when you see Mark Fletcher in the game, AJ Allen in the game, even Chris Johnson in the game, or Jordan Lyle, they're playing like it's their last freaking carry. And it might be, right? Because there's guys ahead of them. Like, they're not the starters. They're playing like they want to be the starter. And the starter's playing like, hey, I'm already the starter. What do I have to worry about? You know, let's just not get hurt and go to the NFL. Like, that's what it looks like. And that's not good enough. So until Damian Martinez starts playing like this is my last carry, these guys are going to be playing for me from now on, until that clicks in for him and he looks like he's playing with a purpose, you know, I mean, maybe they should bench him next game and send him a message. Like, just because you get paid all that money doesn't mean you're here for window dressing. You're not here, you know, to put a TV in Gary Furman's basement and watch it all day. You're here to freaking run the ball like you mean it. Put every ounce of energy you have in your body into each and every carry and do whatever it takes to help this team win games. And Damian has the ability. You know he does. He showed it his first 2 years in college. He's one of the top returning football players that's a running back in college football. And he's okay, not doing well. He's averaging 50 yards a game against bad teams. And, like, that's not acceptable.
All right, but I'm with you on Mark Fletcher. I love him too. Great effort, the whole thing. His results are no better than Damian Martinez.
That's not true.
I'm going to tell you right now. I'm going to give you
more yards per contact after contact and more yards per carry. What else do you base it on? Those are the two main things you need as a running back.
You're giving me stats from Ball State and FAMU. I refuse to acknowledge them. Okay.
You want to look at one game?
Virginia Tech at Miami. Damian Martinez averaged 4.3. Mark Fletcher averaged 4.4. Okay, South Florida and Miami.
Let me interrupt you for a second. I'm going to interrupt you once. Because I'm going to save you the embarrassment of what you're about to say.
No, because I'm embarrassing you.
These running backs all ran against the same teams. Why would you throw out every team they all ran against? Throw out those teams because they didn't do well? What is that? Just pick and choose the ones you like.
If you'll be quiet, I'll give you the three games that matter.
Okay, they don't matter because all the defenses were terrible against the run. Virginia Tech is worse against the run than Ball State.
Maybe that's why they went 4.4 and 4.3 yards per carry. Okay, now, okay, South Florida. Okay, Damian Martinez, 2.8 yards a carry. Mark Fletcher, 0.7 yards a carry. Okay, Florida, Damian Martinez, 4.3 yards a carry. Mark Fletcher, 3.3 yards a carry. This is not as simple as benching Damian Martinez and putting Mark Fletcher in the football game. Everybody hear me. This is not Damian Martinez's fault. This is the run game as a whole's fault. I'm not going to just say the running backs. I'm not going to just say the offensive line. Their chemistry, their timing, their rhythm is off in the run game. It is something that they need to work on a lot, which I'm sure they are, to fix it.
You know, here's an idea. Let's not use Joe Biden's final debate. Let's use the debates he had 4 years ago, because those were better. Let's use those were the ones that mattered. He's not even a candidate anymore. Let's throw out the last debate. Let's just use the ones that matter. They all ran against the same damn teams. And if you look at five games, which is more data points, that gives you better information than picking one game where a guy got three carries and you say he had 0.2 yards on three carries. Oh my God, he sucks. Like, give me a break. You got to look at 20 carries and what happened. You look at three carries versus 20 carries. I'm looking at 20 carries to see what happened.
Yeah, FAMU and Ball State are not data points, okay? Damian Martinez had three carries against Ball State, okay? Yes, Fletcher had six carries and averaged 8.8 yards. Fletcher had a big game against Ball State.
I'm not counting Ball State, man. I'm sorry.
They're all bad defenses. Like, why are you just picking two of them? Five are the same against the run. Virginia Tech's one of the worst teams against the run. Florida is a 60th against the run. I mean, why are you just picking them? Like, they're these amazing run defenses. I mean, they're all bad.
Against FAMU, both Fletcher and Martinez to average 8.3 yards a carry, okay?
I'm not having a discussion that includes those numbers.
Well, according to you, Martinez has been great. You're saying Martinez is great, right? He's the best running back on the roster, according to you, based on the facts?
No, that's not what I said.
I don't understand what you're trying to say.
They don't need a depth chart. They have four or five really good running backs.
Okay, but that's not what we're talking about. We're talking about Damian We're talking about Damian Martinez, and you're saying he's really good because of what?
He is a proven 1,300-yard running back in college football, right, who over his career has averaged 6 yards a carry. Right,
but what makes him good this year?
Because he's averaging four.
So you're saying he played well in two games, I guess you're saying, and that makes him really good? Because I don't think he's played well in any games. That's why I'm misunderstanding you. I don't think he's played well in a single game this year, so that's why I'm not understanding why you're picking two games that you say he did so well in. I don't understand what you're saying.
Three games. It was Florida.
You played well in three games.
Yeah, Florida, South Florida, and Virginia Tech.
Okay, I don't think Damian Martinez played well in any of those three games, so we'll just disagree.
Okay. I am not disputing that he hasn't busted out yet. I totally agree. That's why we're having...
Then what are you telling me three games he did so well in for?
No, I'm saying him and Mark Fletcher were the same against those three teams. That tells me it's not the running back's fault. It's the offensive line is not giving them holes. I feel about it. Now, right, the offensive line's Mario's baby. Nobody's walking into a press conference and saying a word about the offensive line. Just saying. Okay. Because Mario will take that personally. Okay. But those guys need to do better. And I don't see them giving these backs holes. And
this is the problem, Gary. Okay. Mark Fletcher had 7 carries against Florida. 2 of them, he couldn't even keep going because they were touchdowns, short touchdowns. You're not going to average a lot of yards on that, right? So he averaged 3.3 yards a carry. 2 of them were 1 yard touchdowns. How are you going to get it on 7 carries? How can you average more than 3.3 yards a carry? That's really good. Okay, Florida A&M, he had 5 carries. 1 was a short touchdown. Ball State, only 6 carries. South Florida, 3 carries. Virginia Tech, 5 carries. How are you comparing these?
Florida game, he had a 10-yard.
Having less than half the carries of Damian Martinez, yet you're somehow comparing them when he's barely carrying the ball in those three games.
But in the Florida game, for example, Martinez had a 17-yard pickup. Fletcher's longest pickup was 10. I'm not comparing Martinez and Fletcher. I think they're both great. That the point I'm making is one is not busting out over the other.
Fletcher, if you watch tape, Fletcher's playing better at running back right now than Martinez for the whole season. It's just a fact. You can dispute it all you want. It's true.
No, absolutely he's not. Right. And I'm going to give you more evidence here right now. Okay?
You're not giving me any evidence. What do you mean more? What is this? Are you trying to dispute the election results? It doesn't make any sense what you're saying. All this evidence of the election being fake, and they had none. Matt, that's what you're telling me now. You're giving me evidence that doesn't exist.
Matt, you know.
God, let's just end the show. I can't even do this. I'm not doing the whole moderator of the debate thing that's going on tonight. I'm not doing a debate with you with no moderator.
I look at the receiving stats, but I believe Martinez has better receiving stats than Fletcher. And I'm not saying Martinez is better than Fletcher. I like them both. My point is it's not their fault. Okay, that's my point of everything I've been saying. Now, the other interesting thing I thought that came out of Lance Guidry was how he explained to us why they had Isaiah Horton in the game to play defensive back against.
You didn't know why Isaiah Horton was in there? You thought all the defensive backs were hurt? That's why they put him in? Well, seriously?
What he said was it's because all his defensive backs are 6 foot.
Of course. You put in the tallest guy who's a ball hawk on offense.
Okay. Even more support for my standing that you got to put pressure on the quarterback. You know, if you're playing with small DBs and you're relying on one guy to knock the ball down, who's getting screened and butt blocked by the receivers and stuff and getting knocked out of the way. Listen, defending the Hail Mary is a problem for Miami. I think after hearing Lance Guidry yesterday and watching that play on Friday, I will say that defending the Hail Mary is not something Miami wants to be doing. Okay, so I don't disagree much with Lance Guidry, but I disagree with him on this one. I hate prevent defense. I thought he should have gone after the quarterback more on that last drive.
I mean, just so you know, this is not uncommon. DBs are short, okay? They just are. Like, you look at Alabama's DBs, I think they have one guy who's over 6'1", maybe two guys over 6'1", and their entire defensive backs room. Like, that's just the way DBs are built. So, yeah. When you're going to do a pre-event end zone thing, a lot of teams will do that. Like you mentioned, Riley Williams is another one. You pick the tall guy, of course, and they're usually in the receiver's room. Most teams have a 6'4", 6'5" receiver, 6'6", 6'7" tight end. Of course, that's who you're going to put in there, you know, but that's nothing that's a surprise. It's not like this genius move by Lance Guidry. But what bothers me is that the play essentially failed and he said he would do it again. Like, that's what bothers me. Just say, listen, And he, by the way, he precluded it by saying, I didn't want to do that. I didn't want to only rush 3. My brain was telling me, no, bring an all-out blitz. But I didn't do it, and I would do it again. So in other words, what his brain was telling him to do, he would not do that again. It's what is that? I don't understand what that even means. Like, trying to decipher that, I need to get my degree in psychology because I don't know what that means. It sounds like schizophrenia. You think one thing and you do something else. But, you know, I as a schizophrenic, potentially myself, I would never understand what that is.
The thing that makes him a really good defensive coordinator is the fact that he does apply pressure that from different in different ways, that he does get after the quarterback. So why with the game on the line would you go in the other direction? I mean, that's what I didn't understand, and I still don't understand. And I hope that if Miami gets in that spot, they do go after the quarterback the next time because based on the theories and observation, you don't want to be defending too many Hail Marys this year. All right. Listen, enough. We don't have to keep going on and on about Martinez for sure.
Thank you.
But here's what I would love to do on behalf of all of us. Including
I don't know what it is, but I'm going to say no.
No, I would like to. You made an interesting point here a minute ago, and I want to give you a chance to substantiate that. I would love for you at some time this week to get back in the lab.
No.
And I would like to see a comparison of Damian Martinez's running plays this season in comparison to the running plays that he had at Oregon State and see if what you said a few minutes ago really.
You know what that is? That's called a bye week story when we actually have time to write things. That's a project. That's a bye week story.
How about this? If he doesn't bust out.
Wait. And by the way to give our competition an idea for a story. Good job, Gary. Why don't you tell them everything we're going to write about? What else are we going to write about? Tell them all our ideas. Why did that one?
All right, I apologize. But if he doesn't bust that against Cal, I would love to see us do that next week.
We will. And, we got so much to write about during the bye week. It's going to be, I want to do let's tell everyone what we're doing, right? We're going to do our mid-season analysis stories. What else are we going to do, Gary? Are we going to do some NIL deals with players, do some interviews? Who are we going to get? Who are we going to pay? Tell everybody. What are we going to be working on?
All right. I stand corrected. All right. One of the other stories that we have on the website today is Matt's take on what we've learned about Miami's offense and the challenges that lie ahead. And Matt, other than developing a running game, what other challenges do you think they have lying ahead?
Give us
a little prelude to the story.
They do not have.
By the way, listen. While Matt's thinking about this, if you're not yet a subscriber to canesport.com, please come on over to our website, join our community of fans. We have a great time every day on the message boards. We have a great group of fans, very knowledgeable, very constructive conversations. As long as you stay out of the lounge where they go kill each other over politics. I had to create the lounge, which is one of our message boards, literally so that people would have a place to go kill each other over politics and keep it out of our football conversations. But you might like talking politics. So come on over to canesport.com. Please become a subscriber. Your subscriptions allow us to do what we do every single day, including this show, because as much as he loves your comments and your love, there's no chance Matt's doing this for free. Okay. Please, if you're not yet a subscriber to Kane Sport, come on over to canesport.com and join our community of fans. Oh, and also if you're watching on YouTube, which I know you are, hit your subscribe and like buttons because it helps us with the algorithms in growing our audience for the show. So we appreciate that as well. All right, Matt, go ahead. Offense, what do they got to do?
Oh, okay. Well, you know, Cal, as we know, is obviously pretty good, right? Number 23 in the nation in total defense, number 5 in team passing efficiency defense, and in scoring defense, they're actually 12th. So, I mean, they've been doing really well. Now, they haven't really played anybody that can score a lot. You know, Auburn maybe is the best scoring team they've played. Auburn averages, I don't know, like 20-something points a game, nothing great. So they're a little bit untested. And then Louisville is number 17 in total defense and 17 in scoring defense. So those next two games, after that, FSU is 92nd in total defense. Duke is a joke. They just really haven't played anybody, but they're in the top 30. Georgia Tech's 46th in total defense. Wake Forest, 127th in total defense. Syracuse, 67th. So these are not good defenses Miami's playing after these next two games. So like if Cam Ward and these guys get through these next two games, like they're just going to be scoring 40 points a game after that, in my opinion. And by the way, I did some math, which, you know, is hearkening back to my algebra days. So Cam Ward has played 5 games. So if he plays 12 games, not even including any, you know, championship game in the ACC or playoffs, he will finish a full 12-game regular season right now with what he has, stat-wise, with 4,277 passing yards and 43 touchdown passes. He'll also have 350 rushing yards and 5 rushing touchdowns, okay? So he will obliterate by over 500 yards Bernie Kosar's passing record from 1984 and Steve Walsh's touchdown passes record set in 1988, and he'll break that one by 14 touchdown passes. I mean, it's
like keep bottling out of the running plays.
Yeah, that's the right. But that's how remarkable a season through 5 games Cam Ward is having. And if he keeps that pace up, like, you see why he's the Heisman favorite. Like, these are numbers.
He's not the Heisman favorite anymore.
40-year-old records are going to be broken, you know, and all-time records, but they're currently 40-year-old records. I mean, the guy is just off the charts good.
Yeah.
And really the only thing that can stop him is Gary Furman. Gary Furman's negativity.
Turnovers, man. That hurt him last week. He took a blow in the Heisman forecasts because of those turnovers this past week. He's got to protect the football while he puts up the yards. All right. Like I said, we had a couple opportunities to talk to Mario Cristobal yesterday, Matt. And you could tell he's a little on edge. Like, you know, there were a lot of things from that game that rattled the head coach a bit and that he wants to see better. And, you know, he talked about owning it as an organization. You know, he said the effort was really good. The details were lacking. Fundamentals broke down at times. Intensity, detail to preparation has to be really turned up and focused. You know, he had a long list of things that he wants to see get better pretty quickly here with this team. I think it kind of caught everybody by surprise a little bit because they were coasting and winning games so easily.
You know, it's funny. People fell for that. He did an interview on the radio in the morning. It was actually just a replay of last year's Georgia Tech interview after that game. It was not even a live interview yesterday morning. But no, I mean, he always, look, he's great at motivating fans, and he's great, very eloquent, you know, gets everyone riled up, you know, uses some words you shouldn't say, and, you know, uses metaphors, everything. He's great. I mean, he's a great speaker, right? Which great coaches are. They're great motivators. But as you cover him more and more, it's just the same old thing, right? When they don't play well, the message is, oh, you know, we have to get better. We're sloppy. You know, we have to work harder in practice and, you know, fix this, fix that. It's a little attention to detail, the little things, blah, blah. It's always the same thing with maybe a few different words thrown in, right? And when they're playing well, it's always, well, there are always things to work on and we're not there yet and we're a work in progress. Like, you know, like, I don't need that stuff. I don't need his fake injury reports except when players are actually coming back, you know, the week-to-week, day-to-day stuff. Like, come on. I mean, Elijah Arroyo last year was day-to-day all season long and played 1 game. I mean, every week Elijah Arroyo is playing. He looks great in practice, right? So, you know, it's smart because why should Mario let the other team know who's playing? Which actually I was surprised he told the other team that Ruben Bain's playing, quite honestly. That is something Mario usually doesn't do. I'm not sure why he did it this particular week. Usually he will not do that. He'll just say, you know, day to day, week to week with everybody, right? Because why tell Cal, you got to deal with Ruben Bain, bro? Like, why tell them that? Right. I didn't get that, why he did it, but he did. Maybe it was, as Randy Shannon would say, throw a bone to the media, you know. Randy Shannon, by the way, bless his heart, he used to hate doing interviews with the media, like really hate it, like genuinely hate it. And he would say to us, we'd come around, and this is what he'd actually say. He'd say, how about I'll throw you a bone and give you an injury update if I don't have to talk to you guys tomorrow? And so we would have to weigh, do we want to find out about just a couple of players and their status? Or should we get a head coach full interview tomorrow?
Right.
And his interviews were so bad, we'd be like, yeah, just throw us the bone. And he'd be like, so-and-so and so-and-so, bye, and they leave. So, you know, as much as I complain about maybe Mario having the, you know, saying the same stuff over and over again, at least he says it and talks, you know. At least he meets with the media and somewhat enjoys it, or at least puts up with it, because you know, Randy, like me, was a truth teller. And if he didn't like you, you knew it. And if he didn't want to put up with you, you knew it. And if he didn't want to talk to you, you knew it. And he did not want to talk to most people in the media. Barry Jackson, I'm talking to you. And that was that.
All right, we got a few other stories to talk about today, but first, let me switch gears here for a moment and talk a little bit about Caneswear. First, let's hear from Caneswear itself.
Welcome to Caneswear. New store, new items, same great experience. Family owned and operated since 2010, Caneswear has the latest merchandise from the Miami Hurricanes, Miami Dolphins, Florida Panthers, Inter Miami CF, and more. Come visit us at our store in Davie on University Drive, just south of 595, or online at caneswear.com. Caneswear, the spot Miami fans shop.
And yeah, guys, like if you need anything, hats, polos, t-shirts, jerseys, hoodies, hats, flags, decals, magnets, you can get it at Caneswear, which is your ultimate authority for all your Miami Hurricanes merchandise needs. They have all sizes, men, women, kids, babies. They even have gear for your pet. You know, you want your dog showing off that you're a Canes fan? Well, they will give you an outfit for your dog as well. All kinds of tailgate needs fulfilled at Caneswear. If you need tables, chairs, you name it, they have it. They'll even hook you up with Dolphins, Panthers, and Inter Miami gear, too, if you want to support some of the other teams in town. So this is a great time to go get stocked up at Caneswear, which is more than a store. It is an absolute experience at 2655 South University Drive in Davie. That's 2655 South University Drive in Davie, about 15 minutes north of Hard Rock Stadium. And if you can't get to the store, you know, you can always shop them every single day at caneswear.com. So visit the store, 2655 South University Drive in Davie, or go to caneswear.com for all the latest and greatest Miami Hurricanes merchandise that you could ever want to wear and own. All right, Matt. So just finishing up what's on the website today, we do have some recruiting stories. With his recruitment shut down, we have a story on Miami four-star tight end Luca Gilbert. He's totally focused on his senior season, and he's building bonds with fellow Hurricanes, getting ready to come join the program in December. So you can get an update on what's going on with Luca. We also have a story on how Miami is keeping tabs on local Ole Miss wide receiver commit. His name is Samari Reed. He's a 2025 receiver, and you know, Miami is staying in touch with him and just keeping him on the radar, and you know, we'll see how that goes. But you got that update on the website as well. And then we have a story inside the lines feature with Kenye Pepe. Zuby Charles went in depth with him on a lot of different subjects, and you guys will really enjoy that video feature that we have inside the lines with Kenye Pepe. All right, well, that's going to do it for today. For Good Morning Canesport, we have a whole lot of stuff coming your way on the website in the middle of the day as well. We'll be talking to several players today, so make sure you stay on the site. Like I said, if you are not yet a subscriber, please come on over and join our community. You won't be sorry. We do everything that we can do every minute of every day, year-round, to enhance your fan experience to the max. But we can't do it without your subscriptions. So please, please, please come on over and join canesport.com. So for Matt Schodel, I'm Gary Furman. Thank you for starting your day out with us again this morning. And we'll see you next time, everybody.